Yes, so, I mean, I've always been interested in betrayal as because betrayal, there's always something very personal about betrayal, right? You don't get betrayed by an enemy, right? It's always somebody who is close. You know, and if, for example, you know, Thomas Sankara and, you know, and the guy who, you know, who assassinated him, I mean, they were friends, right? They were friends, they were part of the same revolutionary castle. Same thing with Maurice Bishop and the guy who assassinated him, right? You know, so there are ways in which there's this sort of intimacy involved in the political struggle and, you know, and comradeship and so on and so forth that then becomes betrayal. But really, what happens is that, you know, several things happen. One is, you know, of course, you have outside interferences, right? You know, for example, with Lumumba and Mobutu Sese Seko, right? It was the Western powers that initiated the Mobutu coup. But more immediately, it's the failure of the revolutionary movement to offer the structural changes, the fundamental changes it has promised. You know, for example, in Kenya, if you think about the Mau Mau and the betrayal of the Mau Mau, the Kenya Land and Freedom Army, you know, the Kenyatta government that betrayed the Mau Mau never instituted any land redistribution measures, right? Or anything to resemble coming from a situation where you have extreme wealth concentrated in a few hands and extreme poverty amongst the majority population. So it's really the failure of the movement that often has created or left its members that then has no choice but to be. So I'll say that those two angles, one a more personal, you know, a personal angle to betrayal, and then more political and economically motivated.